Blast off. Hello, yes, hello again. We are Geeks Assembled and we have gathered here today. Yes, assembled here today to talk about Day of the Triffids. And it's to talk about the BBC short series version, which was aired in 1981. Yes, all the way back then. And I want to start off by opening thoughts and just give brief opening thoughts, because some people do get a little bit carried away. And they do go on for a whole hour. So we have to heavily edit these videos. We do. We do. Yes. And let's see what Susan has to say about her opening thoughts.
Day of the Triffids, 1981. Cast that I never seen anybody from in. And it was the way I saw it was in three equal parts, three, you know, hour long parts. And it was eerie, scary, fun, bit laggy, bit draggy at parts, but I thought that it was kind of interesting. And all I thought of when I saw the monster plants was, you know, they didn't look even as fearful as the Venus flytrap. I mean, or the one from Little Shop of Horrors. That's just my opinion on the subject. But it was a good watch.
Yeah, I have to say, from my opening thoughts, the Triffids weren't in this as much as I remember. That they weren't in it, because I haven't seen it since I remember watching it in high school, and it would have been for English. So we're talking about, what, 2002, probably I saw it. Yeah, 2002, all the way back then, because I started high school in 2000, so I think it was like 2002. And the Triffids, and I've only seen this once, by the way, the Triffids weren't in it as much as I thought. Does anybody else have any opening thoughts who wants to jump in?
Yeah, the interesting thing about this is that it felt like a Doctor Who story. And the fact that it had no resolution, like it ended with them basically running away from the Triffids, you know, driving away in the armored car. It's sort of an open-ended story. I think actually, was it David Maloney that produced this? Doctor Who stories during Tom Baker's era. So maybe that's where the influence sort of came from in setting it out like a part serial. But yeah, the story itself, I do like how it's sort of from the point of view from someone that didn't see the apocalyptic event that took place to cause the entire breakdown and anarchy of the society, you know, because he got poisoned by the Triffids, Bill, because he works on the Triffid farm. That's sort of a neat sort of concept. But yeah, it's sort of the zombie apocalyptic story, but just with plants. And I think you know, with the oversaturation of zombies these days, to see the same sort of story but with plants is a nice change. And the Triffids, you know, being plants, are quite scary at the same time. They're not, as Alid said, they're not in it as much, but, you know, they have the scary sort of, even though they don't look that menacing, they're still sort of really creepy when they're around. And the music as well is I think the absolute best bit of it, as well as the opening titles.
Can I just say, it did remind me a little bit of Plants vs. Zombies. Have you ever heard of a game called Plants vs. Zombies?
A game on iPhone and stuff, yeah.
Yeah, it's also a game on PlayStation, isn't it? Garden Warfare, and they've got that. Yeah.
I see what you mean, yeah, because I think the plants in that look a bit like Triffid as well.
Yeah, they do a little bit, yeah. What about Alex's opening thoughts? Does Alex want to say anything?
Yeah, it sort of reminded me a little bit of a combination of a treatment of the story, but if you had this story structure of Doctor Who, but you did the style of Blake Seven, It did seem to sort of remind me of that a little bit. Not that I mind. I enjoy that, so it didn't bother me. As far as the book and the other versions, I think they did sort of take a lot of liberties with it, but I still liked it.
And what about Beef Dad? Opening thoughts? We'll get on to characters and that in a bit. Just opening thoughts.
My opening thoughts are, I had watched the 1962 film with Howard Keel and Jeanette Scott, and to be perfectly honest, I thought that this serialization for me never worked.
Oh.
I don't know if it was the involvement of the Australians in it. If it had been done purely by the BBC, I think it might have been somewhat different. But it was a joint production between the BBC and ABC, Australian Broadcasting Commission. I found it, I watched it as it went out, like, but I found it disappointing. I didn't like the plants as much as the ones in the film. I just found it a bit of a disappointment.
And what about Lee? What about Lee's opening thoughts?
My opening thoughts is this serial, like many others like this, has influenced movies like, shall we say, 28 Days Later, The Empty Streets of London. I just love all those scenes. This serial stuck to the book more than the film did and the 2009 version did. This one is more true to the book. But I just love the way it's the, as Connor said, the breakdown of society. The Triffids really aren't the threat.
Mm.
It's the humans who are the threat. As you say, the Triffids are hardly ever in an episode.
Yeah, and that's what, can I just add on to that? That's why they can't go in the cities, can they? Because there's no, it's the humans that are the threat in the cities.
Yeah. It's humans against humans trying to survive, and that for me is a brilliant story. You know, and I enjoyed that part of this serial more than the Triffids side. You could have took the Triffids out of this, and you could have had just the
people go blind, yeah.
Yeah, going blind and seeing how all that went.
Because you've also got rape in this. You've also got the woman who is going to be raped by the gang, who the gang say, you know, look at this nice pair of legs sort of thing. And then you've got the old guy, the old blind guy, and he's got... what's her name, tied to his arm. You know, yeah. So it's quite heavy stuff in this.
Yeah, it is really horrifying, actually. I think more for the as Lee said, the social aspects of it, you know. The fact that the whole society has just crumbled because a meteorite crashed, you know. It really is a sort of... And I think that it's also a reminder about, you know, the world that we live in now, we're maybe not as close as we may think we are, but you know, that any day now, society could become like that.
Oh, you're cheerful.
No, but it is a real...
Thanks for coming on, Connor. You've just cheered everybody up.
It is a real threat, and it's a reminder that, you know, we can't survive in a society like that. And it is really well executed how they have made it where, like, it's uneasy to watch, you know, with the rape, as Alan said, and they just, the whole part collapses.
The BBC was very good in the early 80s making dramas like this. I mean, you had this, you had Edge of Destruction, you had all those, like, apocalyptic Threads, of course.
Yeah, Threads is the one where it's Sheffield, isn't it? After a nuclear...
Yeah, 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 yeah. I mean, there was really good at making these type of programs back then, but they don't make them like that now. It was hard hitting drama, and that's it's good, and we don't do it now.
But you've got people opening because they're all blind, they're like opening soap powder for something to eat, and it's like, it's soap powder, yeah. You know, and stuff like that, and they're opening things that aren't, because they can't tell what it is, can they? They can't see. And yeah, I think that's really interesting. You know, and also leaving people behind as well, you know, letting people die. You know, there's a lot of decisions in this series. They just let people, some people die, they just leave them. People who are desperate for help. I mean,
it's an accumulation of decisions that you really wouldn't want to make in your worst nightmare. You know, like as you said, leaving people behind to die.
And then you've got the diseased as well. And, you know, if you don't help these people, they'll starve because they can't see.
You have to remember, too, that this was a book. This was a book. It wasn't written for television. What you're seeing there is an adaptation of the book. In places, the film veered away from it a little. It still stuck with the this sort of basic premise of society breaking down. And yet it does cause you to question yourself, what would I do in that position if I was sighted? It's the story that makes you ask the question, not this particular production.
What about our favourite scenes? Because I have to say, I thought it began brilliantly in the hospital bed. I thought that was a really strong beginning. And another good moment is when they're in the car and all these hands are just coming on the... Oh, it's, that's a bit freaky, that bit is.
Yeah,
the end of part two or three, where the hands are just coming on the car and they're trying to catch
them. There's a little bit of trivia for you on one of those... One of the men who's putting his hands all over the car, who has a little speaking part in it, is Maurice Barry, who directed Tomb of the Cybermen.
Oh.
He returned to acting in later life. But yeah, I agree with you. It's scenes like that where it's desperate people on the streets. It just makes you sit there and wonder, what if this happened?
Yeah. What about Susan's favourite moment? What was your favourite moment, Susan?
Well, I just want to address the issue that you guys brought up about what would you do. Well, yep. I've been in border cities of Mexico where society is just a thin sort of thread that people are basically, living on the desert floor in boxes, and you know, it isn't like we like to think of it. We like to think of society, and I've lived near and pretty close to it myself, abject poverty, and poverty of sight is no different from poverty of the pocketbook or whatever. People really do have awful decisions to make all the time when things are broken down like that. But it doesn't require a meteorite. Why this falls down for me is that there were these alien plants that could have been so menacing, so entirely, you know, come from outer space, asserting presence on Earth, you know, that sort of thing. Yes, that's a trope. Yes, that's a long-standing sort of science fiction idea. But, I mean, if you want to see broken down culture, it's on planet Earth already. It's in the Coney kids fighting wars with their guns and their bodies at age six in Africa, and on the borders of and in the cities of third world of world the third world, you know, we don't have to make it up on television to see it. It exists. And I'm not sure that science fiction needs to be something that we that becomes like, because of a science fiction event, society is forced to come face to face with itself and turn and achieve a better gain. I mean, that is the reason that I watch science fiction. And that's why I was hoping for these animal plants to be so scary, and then they weren't. And then I was like, oh, dang. Because that's why we watch science fiction, right? Because we want society to turn on a dime and to ascend and get better and do something good. I'm not a dystopian.
But the monsters of this piece are the humans. The Triffids are only doing their natural thing.
Yeah. But the humans are only monstrous because they're blind, really.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
So the way that it's affected the human being's behaviour, the Triffids have just escaped from the farms and just doing their natural things, what they're doing.
But I suppose you could question whether you needed the Triffids at all and whether you could just have made the whole world blind.
And you could have done, but
would it be the same? Would it be near enough the same story?
You should have asked John Wyndon that when he wrote the book. But
it's a bit late now. I know we've travelled back. We've just travelled back, viewers, to 1971. And now we're in 1981. So there we go. What about Alex for favourite moments?
I was trying to remember the book. I'm a big fan of his writings. And, of course, you know, there's been tons of versions of Day of the Triffids and Children of the Damned and all that. I really didn't have favorite moments because I was trying to watch it as a whole. Basically, you know, it's an allegory, set up an example, and just like Twilight Zone and Outer Limits and other things of that era, they show you different things if you were presented with a situation. And, you know, even if you're well-informed, you can't know every single situation, every single war, every single skirmish of who's fighting who and all that. But getting back to the Triffids, I like the story. It felt more like a Doctor Who Blake 7 creation to me a little bit, but not in a family-friendly way. So that was kind of interesting, and it was interesting that they had Lytton from the Fifth Doctor and the Sixth Doctor in the show.
Yes, I was going to mention that. Yeah.
So
you stole what I was going to mention, Alex. What about Beef Dad? Do you have any favourite moments in this?
Yeah, I quite enjoyed the moment where they took the flamethrowers to the Triffids.
Yeah.
That was pretty good, and it looked pretty stark afterwards. But I remember after this had been broadcast, I was working at the Natural History Museum in London, and they actually had one of the Triffids on display at the Natural History Museum in London.
Was he scared?
Not really, no.
They're not that scary, really.
No.
I think there's one growing behind you. Just thought I'd warn you. I think there's one growing behind you.
It's a jade tree.
So what about favourite characters? Let's get on to characters. Really, there's only one character in this, really. Well, there's two. Well, there's a few, but there's one main character, who is Bill.
Yeah. Bill, played by John Dutton.
And he's in it throughout, for the whole thing. It's centred around him completely.
Yeah, I mean, there is a few characters what pop up. I mean, I can't remember the name of the characters, but Gary Olson, who later went on to do 2.4 Children, he played the...
Yeah,
he played the Yob, didn't he? And then he became the army fella at the end of it. He was sort of a good horrible little character. Also, Stephen Yardley, he was in, I think it was episode 2, I think it was, where him and his wife and his daughter were in the flats. And I mean, Stephen Yardley is brilliant, actually. I mean, he's been in loads of things, Howard's Way, Doctor Who and stuff like that. But as you say, Bill just leaves them.
Yeah.
Like the poor guy in the episode 1 in the hospital, who was laid in the hospital bed, who was still alive.
He just
wandered off and left him. The guy couldn't go anywhere because he had his legs strapped up and everything. So what, just left him to die. But it's a little character, as you say. There was Maurice Colburn, as you say, played Lytton in Doctor Who, played Croker.
Yeah.
But it's a little ensemble. I mean, there's not that many main characters.
No, because they're just, some of them are just on it for just one episode and then they're gone, sort of thing, or two episodes and they're gone. Yeah. Anybody else want to mention anything about the characters?
I mean, did it strike anybody that it seemed to have a little bit of a Survivors imitation to it? You know, like the original Survivors mini-series by Terra Nation?
Yeah.
A little bit of that.
Go ahead, Connor. You were going to say about favourite characters.
Yeah, most of the cast, from my understanding, are from Yorkshire as well.
So your home valley. So you should have really enjoyed this. You would have felt at home, Connor.
Yeah, well, I hate Yorkshire. That's a fun fact about me. I hate where I come from. So yeah, but yeah, they are like from Harrogate and Sheffield.
Traitor.
Can I just say Yorkshire? Yeah, Yorkshire is brilliant.
It's the accent I hate.
I like their cheese in Yorkshire.
It's your accent, Connor.
I like that tea as well, according to the famous brand. But yeah, I like how they're mostly from Yorkshire now. It's relatable to me because I'm from Yorkshire and I hate
it. Never. Wow. That is a revelation if there's any of one I've heard. Well, you've heard it here first, people. You've heard it here first. Connor's from Yorkshire. So if you want to hunt him down, just... Yorkshire's quite a big place, though. But we'll put a map on the end of this video. We'll put his address out as well. What about Susan for favourite characters? Did you finish what you were going to say, Connor, by the way?
I was going to say, so it's nice to see some Yorkshiremen getting some airtime as the main character in a TV series for once.
Oh, you like Yorkshiremen? Oh,
bless. I don't like Yorkshire. Again.
What about Susan for favourite characters? If she has any, that is.
I can't remember her name, but the blonde lady that...
Yeah.
Yeah, I can't remember. Was it Sally or what was it?
Is it Joe?
Joe, Joe. Yeah.
She was amazing.
She was a bit of posh totty, wasn't she?
Reminds me of Joanna Lumley, actually, a bit weirdly.
Towards the end, you mean? Towards the end. Towards the end, yeah. Not when she's got short hair.
No.
When she's got long hair, yeah. What about Beef Dad? Any favourite characters or not really?
No real favourite characters. Mind you, Pat Gorman.
Played a blind
man in it. And, of course, he went on to do...
played the blind man. That narrows it down.
A blind man. Not a blind man.
He was in the pub. He was waving. He opened the window.
Yeah.
Oh,
and, he went on to do Tomb of the Cybermen, I believe. I know he was definitely in the Caves of Androzan. Yeah, he did several.
He was a sea devil as well, I think, wasn't he?
He was a bit, yeah.
Come on, don't insult people, Connor.
He was a bit of a stuntman in the John Pertwee era.
Yeah.
Indeed,
yeah.
And he was in The Elephant Man. Which John Hurt was in, who
was he?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And should we talk about the Triffids? Let's talk a bit about the Triffids. What do we think of the Triffids in this? Were we impressed? or did we not find them very, some of you didn't find them very threatening? I know that.
What you've got to remember is this was 1981.
Yeah.
And for that time, they did a pretty good job of designing giant plants. What kills people? What else can you describe it as? I mean, would you want it as a little frilly flowering thing? But no, it's towering above you with this venomous thing. It was okay.
You could have had a bit of air void in it.
Well, yeah, but those little drumming things on the side was a good touch.
Yes, I like that. Yeah. And the noise it made as well. It was like Jaws, really, wasn't it?
Yeah, I didn't know if they were communicating or something.
And they moved around quite well. It doesn't look as bad as you would think, moving plants. Like, I thought, oh, they're going to start moving soon. I thought, how funny is this going to be? You know, but actually, they don't move around that badly.
But they could have made it, like, as exciting or as intense as a Venus flytrap. I mean, they could have taken more clues from earthbound predatory plants and done something. Just my theory. Mm.
Limitations, though, I suppose. What about, go on, Connor, what was he going to say?
Mentioning vervoids, I would like to see this written by Pip and Jane Baker, actually.
Well, that's going to be a bit difficult because one of them's dead.
I think they would have been very good at writing this. Or maybe not, depending on person. But, the triffids themselves were, as I said, they were quite threatening. There was something about them. But I think it was maybe because of the music and the undertone of the story itself being that society is just completely collapsed and, you know, that it is scary as it is. Why do I keep calling them vervoids now? The triffids.
You got vervoids on the mind.
I've got vervoids on the mind, unfortunately.
It sounds like you need to go to the doctors for that, doesn't it?
Sounds like
a disease.
Yeah, an STI or something.
Are you admitting to something here? How can you have an STI?
I don't have an STI.
You're a virgin.
No, but vervoids on the mind sounds like an STI, but I'm just, anyway.
Really?
Yeah, doesn't it?
No, it doesn't.
Oh, God.
Get off the subject.
I mean, it depends where you're sticking things, but never mind, we won't go there.
Right. Triffids.
Talk. At least the sex toy out now.
No, but I mean, again, that's one of the things that science fiction does, is that it takes a situation or a thing or a scenario and makes it scary, just like they did with, you know, Doctor Who and a lot of stories. He's mentioning the vervoids, which was an interesting idea. Wasn't done as well as it should have been done. But the other one is, Terror of the Autons with the plastic, the mannequins that break out of the window, the display window, and start killing people on the street. I mean, for 1970, to show that on television, that's scary.
I want to make a point before I forget it, because I will forget it, is that they wouldn't be a threat to anybody if the people weren't blind.
Yes.
If the people weren't blind, they wouldn't be a threat at all. The reason they're a threat is because everybody's blind, the military's blind, the police are blind, whatever, most people are blind. 99% of the world is blind. So they are a threat because you can't defend yourself really when you're blind. You know, so that's why the triffids, I was gonna say the vervoids then, I've got it on the brain now. Yeah. Spreading. The triffids are a threat in this, is because everybody's blind. They wouldn't be otherwise. They'd be eradicated if everybody could see. Mm. Be eradicated. Yeah.
Well, no, but I mean, guys, isn't there also, you know, in the real world about earthquakes and floods? I mean, there is a point in nature where if something goes wrong like that or if it's too big, even if you have sight, it's dangerous. You know, if you have a big flood or an earthquake, even if you have...
We're on about... Yeah, but a flood...
No, but I'm saying...
I don't even know what I'll do with this.
No, but you see what I'm saying.
I know what he's saying, and he's right.
That they're taking a situation, they're taking a circumstance, you know, that, you know, if, you know, just like the same thing. Water isn't bad for you, but if I drank 2 big gallons...
Well, you'd be going to the toilet a lot, yeah. It'd be bad for the toilet, yeah.
Well, that's assuming that I can still breathe. But anyway, yeah, so you take the situation in science fiction where you turn a concept or a symbol or some scenario on its head and, you know, then see how the humans, you know, fight it or deal with it or whatever. And Doctor Who is very good at that. Twilight Zone is very good at that. John Wyndham is very good at that as well. You know, writing a story based on, you know, that scenario, that concept.
Does anybody else have anything to add on the Triffids, on the actual Triffids themselves?
Yeah, well, I found them a little disappointing.
Yeah.
Found them disappointing, or have you just re-watching it, you find them disappointing?
No, I've always found the ones in the BBC series disappointing.
Now, Beef Dad, did you enjoy the movie versions of it? The movie versions seem more scary.
I haven't seen the latest one. But yeah, I saw the 1960. Was it 63?
Yes. Sorry.
Yeah, I saw that one, and of course it was made and released just before one of the people in it went on to become the Doctor Who's first companion.
Susan, Carol Ann Ford, yeah, that was, I love that version.
She was in the original film.
I love that version.
So yeah. Wasn't the creature... Awesome. Yeah, weren't the plants scary in that? I thought they were scary.
Yeah, they were scary in that. They were. I found them scary in that. Certainly more scary than the sort of sleek things that they had for the television one. They made them look more like picture plants.
Yep.
Which, admittedly, they are carnivorous, but. Yeah, it's the picture plant is not as creepy looking as, say, for instance, the Venus flytrap. Mm.
Well, was it filmed on video as well? It was filmed on video, right?
I have no idea.
Mm. What about the intro? Does anybody have any thoughts on the intro?
A brilliant theme. That it reminded me. I mean, it still sticks in my mind how graphic and. You know, with the faces
and the faces, yeah.
But the music is so what I said the other day, Omen-esque. You know, the film Omen with that music with the voices, it was very similar to that. Very creepy.
Yeah. But like Connor says, the ending is they just travel off into the distance. You never, I don't know whether the book says any different, but you never find out what happens to them. Maybe somebody who's read the book, or
I can't remember. It's a long time since I read the book.
It's a very, very similar, ending, like the birds.
Like the what? Yeah. Oh, the birds. Like the bird. Yeah.
They just drove off into the sunset.
Yeah.
But we may find out because I mean, I haven't listened to it, but Big Finish have done a sequel to the Triffids.
Oh, have they?
It's called Night of the Triffids. So I don't know if it'll carry on straight from where the serial finished. I don't know, but I may have to look it up sometime.
Yeah,
it'd be interesting. Yeah, see what happened afterwards. Yeah, because obviously they just drive off, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't really know what, because they say they go into the Isle of Wight, don't they, or the Isle of Man, or Isle of Wight.
Yeah. Yeah, the Isle of Wicket.
Anyway, should we go to closing thoughts? I think we should. I think we've said enough. We've set our piece, haven't we? So let's go to closing thoughts and our score. So let's go to Susan. What's your final say and score?
I'll give it a 7. No, I'll give it a 7. 7 out of 10. It's watchable. It's got decent acting. I love some of the characters, but I wasn't scared, and it just left me sort of ho-hum. So thanks.
And let's go to Connor.
The breakdown of society was definitely the overall story, and it was the best part of the entire thing. I think overall I'll give this a 7 out of 10.
And Beef Dad?
Yeah, I'm with Susan. It was a ho-hum for me. 7 out of 10.
And is Alex there? Or is he doing some washing up?
I'd say I'd probably give it I'd give it an 8 only because I like the style that how they did it. It's not exactly a recommendation because I like the movie a lot better. I'd rather watch 1960s movie better.
And let's go to Lee. To Hull.
To Hell. Or Hull.
To Hull. To Hull. I did say Hull.
For my childhood memories of watching this back then, it's stuck in my mind, this one. Very vivid of the apocalyptic scenes and the breakdown of society. Brilliant. It makes you think. For me, I'm going to give it a 9. It hasn't stood up well with age, but it's still a 9 from me because it brings back good memories of watching this when I was 11.
I have to say, I'm going to give it a 9.5. I haven't seen it since I was in high school, probably about 2002, as I say. And rewatching it, I found the Triffids weren't in it as much as I thought, and they're not as scary. They're not the threat in this. They're not the threat, but it's like Connor says. It's more about the collapse of society. And what happens if the world went blind, and how would we cope? And that is what would happen. That is exactly what would happen. If we all went blind tomorrow, touch wood, none of it, if the world doesn't go blind tomorrow, that is what would happen. You know, it would just fall into chaos. Society would just collapse. You know, when there would be people trying to smash for food and trying to smash places and, you know, like I say, get food, get drink and stuff like that. And there would be disease because, Lee, what are you doing? Because there leads. I was trying to talk, Lee. Behave yourself. You're going on the naughty list. That's it. And and you really distracted me now. I can't remember what I was saying now. Oh dear. like I was saying, if society, you know, whatever, I'm going to give it an 8.5. Is that your little friendly? Do you call him Craig? Is he called Craig? What you don't know, people, is there's a little hole in the bottom of that. Well, cut that bit out. Anyway, no, Beef Dad's got one now. They're invading. Oh, it's PG Tips. It's the monkey from PG Tips. Anyway, I'm totally distracted now from what I was saying. And bless Susan as she's sitting there eating. What are you eating, Susan? Crisps. Crisps. Oh, they look nice. What flavour are they?
Tortilla.
Okay, everyone. Well, we're all going round to Susan's house for some tortilla crisps. So thank you, Alex, for offering to pay. It's very kind of you for offering to pay for our travel. And we will see you next time. After yourself. Tell us what you think about Day of the Triffids, the BBC version, or any version, in fact, even if it's the newer version or the older version. Tell us what you think below. Because we're off to take Lee to a home now. Because he desperately needs going into care.
Stop it!
Yes. Huh? What did you say, Lee? Susan?
I told him to stop it. He's hurting the kitty.
It's not real. It's not a real cat, Sue. It's his little friend, Eric.
Okay.
Yeah. It keeps him from being lonely. Where is he putting it? I don't want to know.